Chapter 2 of The Adventures of the 11 Cuff Buttons. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. The Adventures of the 11 Cuff Buttons by James Francis Thierry. Chapter 2. As Holmes and I were sitting down to luncheon at 12:30 that noon, and Mrs. Hudson, our old reliable landlady, was placing a fried pork chop on my plate, we were again startled at hearing a terrific banging at the front door. The rain had died down somewhat, but it was still cloudy and disagreeable outside. In a moment more, our own door was thrust open, and another visitor, a young man of about 30, butted in on our privacy.
"Well, I'm sure I beg your pardon, gentlemen," said this guy as he entered, "but I am Lord Launcelot Dunderhow, younger brother of the Earl of Puddingham, whose secretary, Mr. Thornycroft, was here this morning. I came to tell you that since his return, two more pairs of those historic cuff buttons have been stolen, and to see that you come out to the castle on the 1:22 train without fail."
"That's hard lines, ain't it, Launcelot?" said Holmes, as he waved him to a chair. "You'll excuse us if Watson and I go on with our luncheon while you talk. Got any idea who lifted the second and third pair? Any clues at all to the guilty wretches?"
"No, Mr. Holmes, I really haven't," replied Lord Launcelot, as he sat down. "It's quite annoying to have to think about such a disconcerting event so much out of my usual line, don't you know?"
And the Earl's brother contemplated the floor in gloomy silence for the next 25 minutes, while H.H. and I were feeding our faces. When we had finished and had lit a couple of cigarettes, Holmes, handing one to Launcelot, said,
"Well, it's just 1 o'clock. Time to beat it, boys."
"All right, Mr. Holmes, I'm your man," said our visitor.
And, the rain having stopped now, we left the house together, after hurriedly packing a few things in our suitcase. We soon arrived at the station where we boarded the Surrey train. No further word could be got out of our noble companion as we sped through the southern London suburbs and along the country landscape, not even after the April sun had straggled through the clouds and had begun to brighten up the scene.
"Rich gibberish!"
yelled the guard, or words to that effect, as he slammed open the door of our compartment, and the train slowed down and at length stopped in front of a dinky little 2x4 station, with a cluster of worm-eaten old houses and a couple of sloppy-looking store buildings near it that looked as if they had all been erected prior to the Norman conquest, or even possibly antedated the Christian era.
"Well, I guess this must be Hedge Gutheridge, all right, in spite of the guard's mispronunciation of its euphonious name," remarked Holmes, stepping off the train onto the decayed platform, which sagged perilously under his athletic tread.
As Launcelot and I followed suit, a short, nervous-looking man, of about 35, with a florid countenance, rushed out of the ancient station towards us and shouted,
"Oh, Nancy, Nancy, misfortune has followed misfortune upon our venerable family of Dunderhow this miserable day. Two more pairs of those cuff buttons have been abstracted during your absence, making 5 pairs in all that are gone. I suppose this is the eminent Mr. Holmes."
And the noble Earl of Puddingham hurriedly shook hands with my boss.
"Right you are, your lordship," said Holmes. "And here is the egregious Dr. Watson, also at your service. You see, he's my old sidekicker, and I couldn't think of entering upon a crook chase without him tagging along after me to write it up in well-chosen language. Do you get me, Steve? And say, don't worry about the cuff buttons. We'll find 'em all right."
"Assuredly, Mr. Holmes," said the Earl, as we all stepped into a coach that was waiting back of the station,
with Launcelot more gloomy and depressed than ever.
"Home, Olaf, and get a move on."
This to the fat little coachman who drove the ancestral chariot.
"I been get there pooty quick, your lordship," said that Norwegian worthy, as he whipped up the horses, and in 5 minutes' time we had dashed up to a large and imposing stone castle with round towers at each corner, apparently about 500 years old and 5 stories high, surrounded by an extensive garden and park with a small woods in the rear, just the kind you read about with green gobs of ivy hanging down over the gray walls.
"Well, here we are, my friends,"
said the Earl as he stepped out, while two footmen in light green livery assisted us to alight.
"Let's see if I still got the 6th and last pair of my diamond cuff buttons safe here."
He fumbled with his cuffs a moment and added,
Yes, they're still here, what with Lloyd George soaking all the British nobility with his preposterous income tax, and everything going to the demolition bow-wows generally. You can't tell but that you'll be beaten out of your eye teeth the next minute.
As Holmes stepped out of the Puddingham coach and started up the broad stone stairway leading to the main entrance of the five-story castle, he stumbled over a good-sized rock lying on the graveled road at the foot of the stairs, and would have landed on his revered nose if I had not caught him.
"I fear this is a bad omen," said the Earl, frowning, "but I trust it may not prevent the success of our undertaking."
"Don't worry, I wasn't hurt," answered Holmes, and we went up the stairway together. The great bronze door opened, and a lady dressed in the latest London style, or maybe it was Paris, greeted us with,
"Welcome to Normanstow Towers, Mr. Holmes, and Dr. Watson also. I am sure that my husband, the Earl, and all of us will be more than glad if you recover the lost diamond cuff buttons for us."
"I hope so, madam," said Holmes, as the Earl formally introduced us. "We will certainly do our best." The butler, standing beside the Countess Annabel, winked at us as she went into the drawing-room on one side of the corridor, and beckoned to us to enter the library on the other side.
"Well, Harrigan, you may pour us out each a glass of wine," said the Earl, as Holmes, Lord Launcelot, and I followed him into the room.
The library was a very handsomely furnished library, but it looked as if the noble master of Normanstow Towers did more drinking than reading in its luxurious interior, as three trays with at least a dozen empty glasses stood on the broad mahogany table, while a decanter of whiskey, a siphon of seltzer water, and five-quart bottles of wine decorated a smaller table at one side. The butler filled four glasses with some excellent burgundy, and as we finished them, the Earl said,
"We are all Tudor, Mr. Hicks, Mr. Budd, and Thornycroft too, Harrigan."
"They're up in the billiard room, trying to forget the unseemly tragedy that has marred the tranquil tenor of our lives here,"
replied Harrigan, winking at us again.
"Well, I only wish I too could forget it, but how can I? King George will never receive me again if those precious cuff buttons aren't coughed up."
And the Earl started up the stairs to the second floor.
"Come on and join them, Mr. Holmes, before you begin your usual tape-measuring snooping around with a magnifying glass and analyzing cigar ashes. You see, I'm on to all your little tricks."
"Well, say, hold on a minute, Putty, or I mean your lordship. I don't mind stalling a while before I begin pulling off my historic stunts, as this detective business is only a graft anyhow. But as my long suit has always been to criticize the regular police force, I must ask you why in thunder those constables from the village aren't here on guard, considering that three successive thefts have occurred here in the same day," remonstrated my friend.
"Oh, they went back to Hedge Guthridge at noon," replied the Earl, shrugging his shoulders, "telling me they would wait till all six pairs of cuff buttons were stolen before they would do anything more, as they would probably have more clues to follow."
"Can you beat it, Watson?" said Holmes to me as we ascended the elegant stairway to the fourth floor. "These guys are just about as brainy as the average American cop I bumped into on the other side of the big pond."
On the fourth floor, we entered a large room with a billiard table and a pool table in it, where four men were busily engaged in killing time, two at each table.
"Put up your cues a minute, Uncle Tudor and the rest of you, while I introduce you to Mr. Hemlock Holmes, the celebrated butter-in on other people's business, whom I have hired at an exorbitant price to run down the depraved scoundrels who cabbaged my diamond cuff buttons. If he can't catch 'em, nobody can, I guess. Mr. Holmes, meet the Countess's uncle, Mr. J. Edmund Tudor of Hyderabad, India, my friend Mr. William Q. Hicks of Saskatoon, Canada, and Mr. William X. Budd of Melbourne, Australia."
The Earl had us shake hands with the three.
"My secretary, Eustace Thornycroft, you have already met."
"Hello, Holmes, old fellow,"
was the smiling greeting of this worthy.
"I'll suit you a game of pool. Billiards is too intricate a game for my limited intellect to follow."
"All right," agreed Holmes with a grin. The Earl stepped to a speaking tube on the wall and called downstairs to the butler.
"See here again, hurry us up with a box of Havanas, will you?"
In a minute, the jovial master of refreshments came running up the stairs with a box of cigars under each arm.
I thought I might as well bring two, your lordship,
he explained. Sure, Harrigan, hand them around. Now smoke up, gents, said the Earl. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. As long as I've still got the last pair of those blasted cuff buttons in my cuffs.
Here he took off his coat and displayed to full view the famous heirlooms which gleamed like a pair of locomotive headlights.
We'll wait till tomorrow before tearing up the foundations of the castle looking for the others.
So they played on at pool and billiards for the rest of that Monday afternoon, Hemlock Holmes and the six gilded loafers, while I sat idly in a chair at one side, smoking several good cigars, my job being that of an innocent looker-on, trying to figure out who is the biggest fool in the place, the easy-going Earl of Puddingham for shoveling out good money to my grafting partner, or Holmes himself for frittering away his brilliant talents in such piffle pastimes. At 6 o'clock we were served a delectable dinner in the great oak-paneled dining-room of the castle, prepared by the Earl's French chef, Louis Le Violet. And we passed the evening in the library sipping away several more bottles of the Earl's best vintages and listening to the more or less improbable tales of their adventures in the three faraway realms of the world by Messrs. Tudor, Hicks, and Budd, while Holmes managed to pump Harrigan on the QT and found out from him that the Earl was rated at £2,000,000 in the form of several thousand acres of valuable land up in Yorkshire, including one or two good-sized towns. At 10:30, Holmes and I retired for the night, having been assigned to one of the more spacious guest rooms on the third floor, and we were soon wrapped in slumber. End of Chapter 2. Recording by Paul French.